Welcome, everyone. So glad to have you here today. Dana, can you go back one slide, actually, because I have a couple of announcements. For those of you who do not know who I am, my name is Terry Torzinski. I am the Michigan School Counselor Association president. On behalf of the governing board, we are so excited to partner with the Michigan Department of Education, as well as Counselors for Computing, to bring you this webinar today. And as Dana had said earlier, we had 500 people sign up for this event. 500. And that was a cap. We had to stop there at 500. One thing that we're doing at MSCA this year is we're trying to increase our professional learning opportunities for school counselors across the state. So we just want to make a couple announcements for all of you. If this is something that you really enjoy today and you want more information, we actually have a virtual spring conference coming up. So we're asking you to save the date on Friday, April 30th. There will be a virtual spring conference that's all around career development. So the Counselors for Computing group will be doing the afternoon session. And in the morning session, we'll have our Michigan School Counselor of the Year, Betsy Kanagawa, as well as myself and Tony Warren talking about how we connect career development to the Ask a National model. So it's going to be a great day. We will have 6 career development sketches available at that time. So stay tuned for more information. We're excited about the event. We're excited to bring Counselors for Computing back with the Michigan Department of Education. It's going to be a great time. So save the date for that. I know there will be questions about sketches. So at the very end of this presentation today, there will be a hyperlink for a Google form in which you'll have to complete in order to get your sketches. So it will ask then for your PIC number. It'll ask a couple more questions as to who you are, and that's how we will award the sketches. So please make sure if you need those sketches, you complete that form at the end of the session today. And then one more ask. We are, again, trying to increase intentionality around providing more professional development to meet your needs, especially around the areas of college and career. And so we do have a survey that is linked here in the chat, this bit.ly, or I will drop it in the chat right now, that if you complete that survey, it's just giving us some information as to what type of PD we can offer all of you in the state of Michigan. So again, welcome. So glad to see all of your faces and all of you here today. And I'm going to kick it over to Cheryl Wilson, who represents Michigan Department of Education as the computer science consultant. So welcome, Cheryl and team. Looking forward to learning from all of you today.
Thank you, Terry. I am so happy to be here today, and I am so happy to know that we have so many counselors that are interested in computer science and how they can provide some resources to their students and their staff regarding computer science. We found out with a landscape report last year that our counselors were one of our missing keys. We need you to help share the news about how great computer science could be and what opportunities are out there for our students. So today I am fortunate to be able to share with you, we have 2 counselors from Pennsylvania, and I'll give you a little intro on them, and they're going to be sharing with us, and then I'll come back in at the end. We have Dr. Christina Yu Greenlee. She is passionate a school counselor in Pennsylvania with over 19 years of experience working in the field of education and counseling. Dr. Green has experience working in rural, urban, and suburban school districts as a school counselor. And Dr. Green believes in NCWIT's mission to revolutionize the face of technology by developing programs for our members to achieve goals focused on policy reform, image change, and outreach to underrepresented groups in technology and computer science. And then we also have Dana Weil. She is a school counselor at Penn Manor High School in Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. Dana began her exploration into the intersection of technology education and a counselor's role when she was an academic advisor at Lord Fairfax Community College, advising students for transfer degrees and applied associate degrees. And she was introduced to NCWIT when a technology teacher gave her a kit, kind of like you're going to get today. And after that, she kind of realized, oh my goodness, I could have used this years ago. So she is now someone who helps with NCWIT, and she loves to be a further advocate for equal access to computer education for women and other underrepresented populations. So with no further ado, we have our 2 guest speakers today. Thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl. Dr. Green, do you want to say hi so you'll pop up on the screen too?
Absolutely. Hello, everyone. I'm so excited to be with you today and present about our role as school counselors in computer science. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, so I'm actually into the first part of our intro without clicking over because I wanted you guys to notice on this first slide, you can bring up these slides interactively if you would like. And there's that bit.ly link in the yellow box. So we can bring it up again at the end if you want it later. But I'll leave this up for a minute if you would like. So Christina and I are both practicing school counselors in the schools. And then we also partner with an organization called National Center for Women in Information Technology. And we convene, equip, and unite more than 1,200 change leader organizations to increase the influential participation of all women, all races, ethnicities, class, age, sexual orientation, and disability status into the field of computing. And then NCWIT, they work in businesses, in colleges, and the K-12 setting. So this Counselor for Computing program is a subset of the K-12 work that we do as an organization. And so we also expand, even though women's in the title in the K-12 setting, there's a big, big focus as well as other marginalized populations. So we are hoping this is just a small introduction to what the work that's happening in Michigan and the work that we can continue to do to partner together in our state for this work. So why school counselors, right? So Cheryl said that, as a computer science consultant, they looked at, the work across the state and there was a missing piece for school counselors. You may have noticed on that first slide that organizations like Apple and Merck and Coca-Cola are sponsoring these programs for counselors. So why are people worried about counselors and what do we have to do with computer science? So we have a unique role. You all know, I don't need to go over it too much, right? We have a unique role in the building in terms of individually working with students, getting to influence the systems at play, working with administration, working with community members, working with teachers. Besides any principal, there's nobody else really doing that kind of work across the board with so many different stakeholders that the school counselor is, and we get to do it in such a unique way. So we are uniquely positioned to be able to work with students one-on-one and also think about like what could be systematic barriers preventing these marginalized populations from getting involved in these various career fields that could be really beneficial to them. So what is computer science? If you want to use a little reaction button, I don't know if it's up there for you guys, about, a thumbs up or high five or whatever about if you've heard of computer science. Sometimes people hear it and they sort of are a little overwhelmed by it. But when it comes down to it, it's posing a problem in such a way that a computer can help solve it. And it is interdisciplinary. So for example, the woman featured on this slide, she is utilizing a microscope that is connected to a computer that has a specific algorithm to help restore artwork that has been damaged, to calculate the other colors and cells around it, to figure out what color paint and what formulas needed to restore these damaged precious pieces of art. So another key area is that it is used to store, share, retrieve, manipulate, and secure information. And the secure is a big one right now with cybersecurity. If anybody's account information was hacked recently about anything, all of that is relating to computer science. Make sure my optimized.
Okay. Computer science is everywhere and it is changing everything. We are going to get ready to watch a video that is available at code.org. And I want to just share, when I was a participant in this program and I watched this particular video, that's all it took to hook me to really make sure I was doing my work as a school counselor with introducing students to computer science. So while you're watching this video, please keep in mind what our students might find innovative or interesting and information that's presented in this video. And then also, I want you to think about what adults or parents and community members might actually find that is innovative and interesting in this video as well.
I think 19th century was about the Industrial Revolution, about electricity, about disrupting the agricultural society and making it more advanced. The 20th century was about physics and engineering to do more things easier in our everyday life, from refrigerators to washing machines.
How convenient.
And the 21st century is definitely the digital age. It's the internet.
Even if you want to become a race car driver or play baseball or build a house, all of these things have been turned upside down by software.
The LettuceBot is a robot that can sense its environment. Every single hour, this LettuceBot is seeing 1.5 million plants, and it's taking individual action on those plants. We enable lettuce growers to have higher yields in their field by helping make it cheaper, by helping produce food in a more sustainable way. And that wasn't previously possible without computer science and technology.
I have a really fun job where we build Polyvore, which kind of combines all my favorite things, so programming as well as fashion and art and design and shopping. Half the products you use these days are software products that you play with on maybe your phone. And so if you want to build something cool, you need to know programming, right? And there's so many things that you can do with computer science. So if you just work backwards from the cool thing that you want to build and figure out what that is, a lot of times computer programming is part of that, right? So you should learn the skill.
It's really exciting right now. The technology that we're developing right now is going to be used by your doctor in the next decade. When you come into the office and you're sick, now the doctor is going to be like, all right, spit in this cup. And I will put it into this magic machine, which is the sequencer. And in an hour, I can tell you what you have or what's wrong with you. So if we're looking for a new virus, for example, we'll download a database of all the viruses that are known. And we'll search for, our sequence of interest against a whole database of all viruses. So you still need somebody to analyze the data. The computer is not smart enough yet.
Our software helps people save energy and thereby reduce their carbon emissions. To date, we've saved over 8 terawatt hours, which is the equivalent of about 1.1 million cars on the road.
When you're forecasting the wind, there's so many different parameters that go into it. It would be impossible for a human to sit down and do all those calculations. We need a computer model in order to forecast it.
I write software which scans images, looking for bad images, images that we know are illegal. I work very closely with organizations like the National Center for Missing Children. I know that the work that we've done has impacted the life of people. And I feel very strongly about it because there's a lot of social problems right now that could really leverage the use of technology. It's a lot about empowering the people who are there helping the world by giving them the tools to be able to do better. That's something that we can do right now, and the tools available are huge.
The merging of art and technology is getting more and more significant now. Because computers and software are such an integral part of our lives day to day, people are realizing that it can be quite creative to take this medium of computers and create incredible works of art.
In Finding Nemo, when Crush and Squirt and all the friends are flying through the East Australian Current, you're seeing images of water flowing by, you're seeing the colors on the back of the turtle, you're seeing the sides of the fish. All of those things are generated through math and computer programs that we write that we then give to the artists, and they take that to create that final image and tweak it and make it look beautiful and look fun.
the crux of it is really about invention. It's about looking at the world and being dissatisfied with things and questioning everything.
I always felt like if I didn't learn how to program, it would be like not learning how to read. You know, the future would just be closed to me.
If you're in the coding profession, there's so many things that you can do, and you can pretty much pick and choose the course you want to be in.
I think that, I mean, you can start something in your college dorm room, and you can have a set of people who haven't built a big company before come together and build something that a billion people use as part of their daily lives is just crazy to think about, right? And it's humbling and it's amazing.
Really, it's about the chance to reinvent things and then see it out there in the world and see people using it and having fun or having a better life because of something that wasn't there before that you put in the world.
Okay, so we are now going to invite you to do another Mentimeter concerning what you just observed in the video. So pretty much what you just saw was computer science plus X. So it was the intersection of computer science through all of those various fields. So which of the following segments might feel most innovative to students? So what might they find unique and surprising? So you can get ahead and participate in the Mentimeter. We're going to give you a few moments.
If you're able to have your Mentimeter up earlier, you can just refresh if you're just joining us. Menti.com, and then use the code 5674987. There's the top. When I've done this with students, some of the lettuce spot stuff has been kind of surprising to them.
Okay, and it looks like arts and entertainment is winning. And we have a tie with agriculture and fashion. Okay, thank you for those of you that have participated. And the next is what might be unique to adults that have watched this particular video. And then I'll summarize at the very end.
Another way to think about it is what did you think is the most interesting?
Mm-hmm. So again, we're at menti.com and you just put in the code that was shared in the beginning. Let me put that again.
There it goes. I might have just needed me to refresh for some reason.
Okay, there we go. Okay, we have agriculture and medicine that right now look like they are the highest percentages as far as what was innovative to adults. So in the past, when we have shown this particular video to students, and again, it is available to you at code.org, so you can share it with your students. Typically, you would think that maybe the kids would be kind of intrigued with all the art and the fashion and the entertainment areas. However, our kids are kind of growing up in this very heavy digital age, and that was mentioned in the video. And we typically have our students that are really surprised by the lettuce spot and how computer science intersects with agriculture. It's something that they really don't think about. So you can introduce this to, as you can see, I'm a K-8 counselor, and we all eat food. So this is something that you can introduce to very young children, preschool, pre-K, kindergarten, all up, on up, how computer science is actually involved in agriculture. And typically the adults are pretty intrigued by the medicine. And I know the individual in the video was talking about in the next decade, but guess what? It is here and now, right now. So 23andMe, you provide saliva and they can give you a whole scan as far as your genetics and different types of diseases and disorders. We also have now that is coming right to us in our mailbox. You can even have a scan done to determine what type of food allergies you have. You just provide them with blood and then they'll have a computer analyze it for you and provide you with a report. So there was actually a very interesting story about a teenage girl who was having suicidal ideation. And when she went to the hospital and they were trying to determine what medications would best support her needs, they actually took a swab of her cheek and they analyzed her saliva and they were able to determine what medication best worked for her biology. So that is another example of how medicine has really intersected with computer science.
So here is sort of the broad thinking that happens in computer science, the computer science teachers are trying to teach and work with our students on. And there is also a lot of ways that this idea of computational thinking is also being, and design-based thinking is also being used in other fields as well. So I'm going to go through this super quickly for today since we just have an hour. So this is the idea of kind of breaking down the problem into smaller parts, identifying similarities and trends, targeting what's important, then creating a step-by-step list of instructions to complete this task and try to solve the problem. Again, the goal is using a computer to solve a problem, right? And then debugging. So you're going back and you're kind of redoing some of these steps to reflect on what went well and what steps need to be taken and revisited and refined to get to the best solution. Now, anybody hear any connections with some of the work that we do with students? So if we go back to our ask of mindsets and behaviors, thinking about developing self-confidence, understanding their goals, having some of their own belief in their ability to achieve and do their best work, and having a positive attitude towards learning. These kind of go into some of the essential skills as well that it takes to be good at computational thinking and problem solving. So when you, for example, are maybe working with a student on self-discipline or self-control, and they're, you know, you're trying to identify, well, like, what's the problem? Why aren't you getting your homework done, right? Like, let's break it down into smaller pieces here. Here's some other examples of ways that it connects to our behavior self-management standards. One thing we find a lot is students who they run into a problem and they give up on it quickly. We know we run into that emotionally with students and we're working through them, but that's a skill that's really important in computational thinking and computer science as well, is not giving up when you run into a problem. So a lot of these things that we're teaching from an emotional aspect or career aspect also are similar self-management skills that would be used in computational thinking.
So why does expanding access to computer science really matter? And this particular slide is also available at code.org for you to be able to share. Computing jobs are the number one source of new jobs in the United States, and there are jobs across all industries in every state. So there's that intersectionality that we talked about again. There are more than 500,000 open jobs in computing right now, and they're unfilled. So computing right now is representing the number one source of new wages in the United States. And these jobs are predicted to grow at twice the rate of all other jobs. So right now in your state, there are over 9,500 open computing jobs that have been unfilled. So we have kind of had this mantra about STEM, and pushing STEM across the past 10 years or so, probably even a little before that. So really, when we're talking about the problem in STEM, it is really a computer science problem. So right now, there is a gap in computer science. So there are 67% of all new jobs in STEM are in computing, as we mentioned, the intersectionality. Only 11% of the STEM bachelor's degrees are in computer science. So there really is a huge gap here that we as school counselors can help to fill as we're introducing our students to career development. I absolutely love this slide. And this slide you can actually access online as well. So this is a slide that represents Okay. So this slide represents the various fields, and we're really going to just focus on, for sake of time today, the social services and then also the computing jobs that are out there. And when you look at the kind of the light green color, that is actually the number of jobs that are projected between 2016 and 2026. And the teal color are the degrees, the bachelor's level degrees that are in that particular field. So if you take a look at social services, we have a huge percentage of degrees out of all of these particular fields and a very small percentage of jobs that are in that particular field. Then if you look at this a little more closely, the darker color of the teal, the solid color teal, is the representation of men in the in this particular field. And the polka dot white and teal is the representation of women. So you can also see across this particular slide, also master's degrees and doctorate degrees as well, if you take a look at the key. Now, let's take a look at computer science. So there's a projection of 350,000 jobs that will be coming up in the next 10 years or so. And there is a huge gap in how many people are actually graduating with a bachelor's degree in this particular field. Then if you take a look further, the representation of men versus the representation of women. And I don't want to only focus on the traditional gender, men versus women. There's also an untapped resource of individuals from diverse ethnic backgrounds, nationalities, racial groups, and also individuals that identify, have different gender identity.
So we're going to do a little pop quiz again. We're going to get back on Mentimeter. Some of these you won't know, just to help us learn together in an interactive way. So menti.com. If you have a phone as well, you can also bring up your camera. It's the same link as before. So if you still have it up in a tab, it just right now probably has our logo on it. I'll switch over to that here. Okay. So the average salary in Michigan overall for any job is $49,510. What is the average salary for someone in the computing workforce in Michigan? I'm going to show the correct answer here. So $78,000. And I think if we're thinking about the gap here, you know, if these positions are mostly filled by men and the average is so much higher than the general average. Who is being left out of these wages? Okay, according to code.org, how many job openings or computer jobs unfilled are there in Michigan today? Lisa, I saw your comment. It would be interesting, Lisa, I think. So Lisa commented, if you're watching the chat, that if it's 157,000, she's changing jobs. It'd be interesting to break this down by a bachelor's degree, right? So like if they just used raw data, the data nerd in me, right, to say that these are all the average salary overall, it'd be interesting to see like the average salary of someone with an education degree in Michigan, bachelor's degree, versus someone with the average, you know, bachelor's degree in computer science. So we are job openings. Thought I clicked correct answer. Maybe that is it. Okay. So, oh, there it is. Look, it's in bold. Sorry. So 9,694 job openings as of when we made this. Okay. What percentage of computer science bachelor degree recipients were women in 1985? So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The average is 37%. Surprising, huh? So how about 2 years ago? What was the percentage of computer science bachelor degree recipients for women in 2018? Okay. So 21%. Can you believe it's gone down since 1985? Okay. Hispanic women make up 18% of the U.S. population. What percent of the computing workforce identified Hispanic women in 2019? When we do a lot of work with NCWIT, we tend to use the term Latina or Latinx, but when we're looking at data from the U.S. Census and surveys and things, they often use the language that's in the census, which is Hispanic. Okay, looks like slowing down a bit here. So the total is 2%. It's actually the smallest group represented in computing fields. So NCWIT actually has one of our sub-programs is called Tecnolachicas, and it's working directly to try to increase this access to computing careers to Latina women. Okay. More girls are taking the AP computer science exam. In 2015, over 10,000 young women took the exam. How many do you think took it in 2018? And based off of how old this is, I believe we're looking at AP Computer Science A, because there are two computer science exams now. And the correct answer is 38,000. So is a drastic jump, which is awesome. Hopefully that'll pay ripples on this data in the long run. Okay, so we are gonna head back over to our slides.
Okay, so again, why are school counselors being involved in this work of introducing computer science to our students, and more specifically to our girls? So there are four areas that can influence a girl's decision to pursue computer science, and we have those listed here on the slide. So the first is encouragement. How much do we encourage our girls to seek out computer science and other untapped individuals represented in computer science. Also, the career perception. So what does a student actually think computer science is? And a lot of times our students really don't even understand. So we have to start off by explaining what it is. Also, self-perception, what the untapped individual thinks of themselves that might not be represented in computer science historically. And then lastly, academic exposure. And this is huge for us as school counselors. So is computer science even available in your school? Is computer science seen in your school and talked about? Is it in the coursework? And are the untapped populations being introduced to these classes and being also felt welcome when they do end up registering and participating in these classes? So to talk a little bit more about our role with encouragement, and this is coming straight from the ASCA Ethical Standards Preamble. School counselors are advocates, leaders, collaborators, and consultants who create systemic change by providing equitable educational access. School counselors demonstrate their belief that all students have the ability to learn by advocating for an educational system that provides optimal learning environments for all students. School counselors are social justice advocates, support students from all backgrounds and circumstances. So again, there's the answer to why school counselors. It's what we do. We encourage the students that we work with. So we look at barriers. We take a look at the data, we disaggregate it, and then we try to work to close the gap systemically. So moving on to talk about self-perception, and again, our role as school counselors as well as encouragement. And if you take a look at this slide, teachers tend to encourage boys to pursue computer science 1.5 times more than our girls, and underrepresented individuals are encouraged. Parents at the rate of 1.7 times. So even in your own household, what type of messages are you giving your girls? And then in the media, 2 times as likely for boys to be represented and to feel encouraged based on what they're seeing in the media. So these are very small areas that we can really make huge impacts just in how we support self-perception and encouraging our students.
So we dig into this a little bit more in some other trainings, but just thinking about like helping kids expand their ideas that computer science isn't just like sitting there going la, 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 on a computer all day. You know, it has these broad connections to various fields and their interests. We have this idea of CS plus X. So like computer science plus whatever variable, whatever else that you're interested in. I'm sure there's a connection. And if you're thinking about, just helping kids think about things a little bit differently, instead of asking them, you know, what they want to be when they grow up, if you ask them what problem they want to solve, and then there's also like, how can technology then help you solve this problem? So one way to help with this self-perception, academic encouragement, and encouragement in the field is NCWIT's Aspirations in Computing program. So NCWIT has a program for high school and college girls. It's an award program. And girls just need to be interested. It's for those aspiring to be in computer science. So if you are a high school counselor, definitely be on the lookout to recommend your girls to these programs. It plugs them into a great community. Hopefully we're going to have a guest speaker from this program in future presentations. So you will get to hear from some people that have won it in your own state. So I'm going to switch stuff over to Cheryl here to talk about the academic exposure in and the academic work that's happening in your state and how this applies to you guys in the K-12 continuum.
Just a second, switching over here. All right, well, thank you. Yes, I'm so fortunate to be able to be Michigan's computer science consultant, and my job is to work to get computer science implemented in the districts in Michigan. So, let's see here. There we go. One of the things we found out, and this was with the State of CS report, it was put out by a code.org coalition. In Michigan, there were only 37% of high schools that offered computer science. So when you start to look at that as it stacks up against the other states, we have a long road ahead of us to try to get computer science in all of the various schools. And you'll notice I have some links on here. So later on with the slide presentation, like if you want to check more of the report, it is linked in there. So you can check that out on your own. And I wanted to bring this to your attention, and I know we talked a little bit about AP, and this just kind of shows some of the issues that we're seeing, that basically the AP participation, you're going to notice a big difference with the male-female, and basically we have less females participating in APCS as well as students of color. And so you're kind of noticing some themes and some issues with computer science, and we'd like to break that cycle, and we'd like to bring it to more students and make it more available. Here you're gonna see in Michigan's DTMB, the Department of Technology Management and Budget, shares a career outlook, and it's projected through 2028. And again, I have a link up here, but it's just showing you some of those careers that students have an opportunity to access. And one of the things, let me just bring out right here, we have some that are very specifically calling out computer science. However, there are many careers that are listed that use those computational thinking skills that we addressed, such as like abstraction. Let me just give you an example of a nurse. We all meet with a nurse, and then let's say, you know, you met with a doctor and they gave you, the nurse comes back in to tell you what, you know, what you have to do. Well, the nurse needs to abstract all those big details and basically just tell you the general, this is what you need to know when you go home and what you need to do. So pretty much all of us in whatever career we're going to do are going to use those computational skills. One thing I like to make sure I share with school counselors, districts are allowed to provide their fourth year math credit can be a computer science credit. And I went ahead and I put this here from the Michigan Merit Curriculum. So if you want to see a little bit more on it, obviously the link up there. But a lot of schools aren't aware of this. Let me just give you an example here of one school district, Ann Arbor. They offer computer science principles, which is kind of just an opening, like an introductory course to computer science for students. It is able to meet that fourth year math credit and also give them computer science skills. So That's maybe something you want to think about and ask questions and look in your district. If you don't offer it, would you like to offer it? Or if you do, are you giving those students some of those credits that they can use? I have a list here of like some Michigan courses linked there, but just to kind of talk about, we've talked about there's some computer science courses. There's something called Computer Science A, and there's Computer Science Principles. And just so you're aware, like Computer Science A right here is basically a little bit more coding focused, kind of like what we traditionally think. It would be beneficial for the student looking towards a CS career or like a STEM field career. On the other side, there's more of an introductory course called Computer Science Principles, and that would be more of a focus on problem solving, but they do some light coding in there, so it still is addressed. But these would be more for the students who are going for other careers beyond maybe computer science or STEM, but just to go ahead and get some of those skills to be able to use in whatever career they select. And here I have a link. I have worked with some other individuals, and we have like a one pager. So for school counselors, this shares some easy information with you. So if you click on that link, it'll get you there. Basically a little bit about careers, and then also what can you do to increase student access to computer science careers and opportunities for students. And again, I have a link here as well. There are also some other one pagers you might be interested in for like students, for parents. We've done a good job of trying to give you some easy one pagers to share out. Just a second, I lost my mouse here. There we go. This is a link showing you the Michigan Computer Science Standards page. And this is just for probably more for your teachers. If you're not aware of what computer science are available, what standards there are available. And it also is a link to the one pagers that are there. One of the things we're doing, and this might be of interest to your district, if you don't think your district has a computer science plan, like I don't even know if they do, they have computer science, what's their plan, like K-12, we now have something called like a script workshop. And what we're doing is we're looking at can we walk the district through, get a vision for the district, get some goals? How can we lay a computer science pathway for students, K-12, so that they can interact with computer science? This is a link to the script workshop, like a flyer, and you'd end up contacting me, and we will get something set up for your district. Also, if you're more of a Twitter person, we post on @CS4MI. We like to post opportunities, especially like NCWIT things that are happening. I like to any PD that I come across or resources. So check that out. That might be something you're interested in. And then talking about like clubs and more opportunities. A lot of times these out of school clubs can be what can bolster the students, you know, like they've never known anything like it. And that might be a great experience for them. A CS club can expose students to career fields, provide hands-on experience, and engage community stakeholders and cultivate interest. Or maybe you just offer like a computer science night. That might be something that students might be interested in. And so here we are. We're getting near the end.
Carol, can I just jump in there?
Yes.
Yeah. So for our elementary school counselors and our counselors sort of, you know, thinking about this and saying, you know, kind of what do I do next? There's ways, one, if you already have computer science, I would challenge you to look at your school's data and pull up those rosters and see where your school lies and start just talking to people about it, you know, see if you can get some other people interested. And then I would say, especially for our K-12, because these early perceptions of who you are and who you're going to be sort of frame in those early years. So looking at your career lessons and saying, you know, who am I representing? If there is any conversation about computing, am I just talking about like, you know, white men in computing, or am I, you know, looking for women in computing and people of color in computing, and am I highlighting them? So you may not even need to do anything major to kind of address some of these issues. You can look at the lessons and the materials you're already using. You know, you're bringing in a career speaker, and just be intentional with who you bring in as that career speaker for, you know, the topic related to computing. So hopefully we'll get to give you a lot more information about this in the future and do a lot of brainstorming and work on this together. But yeah, just start thinking a little bit differently.
All right. So I know we've gone through a lot of information here. There's a form, and it's you'll see the link there. And I think if somebody can throw that in the chat for
people. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can do that.
But what is pretty awesome is you, by completing this, and for those that attended the live session, you will be able to get a kit with a lot of resources. And it's going to be like a virtual reality headset. There's going to be posters. The career profile cards are really awesome. Those are a great way just to share some information out with, especially a lot of your girls. How are they, you know, how do they see themselves in a career possibly? And it may not be what you might think is sitting in front of a computer, just sitting there coding. As we've seen in some of those videos, there's a lot of different ways that girls can have careers with computer science. So do make sure that you get the bit.ly on that, and it must be completed. So we got to say all that good stuff. And so I am going to go ahead and go on this last slide. I myself was a person, when I went into college, I didn't know quite what I wanted to do. I knew I wanted to be a teacher. And then I liked math, and I had no idea what I wanted to pair with it. And I was fortunate to be able to take a computer science course in high school. And I don't know, I'll try it. And so I just want for you to know that I was so blessed, and I think it was a great opportunity. And then when I saw this quote, I actually went to Kelvin, and I think, oh my gosh, I could have even done something else when I read this quote. And just from Nikita here from Kelvin, she said, during high school, I was discussing career options with my school counselor. She saw that I had been taking a lot of classes that utilized problem-solving skills, as well as numerous art classes. So she suggested I look into a computer science as a career option. When I learned how computer science could be a great creative outlet for me, I decided to pursue it in college. I enjoyed my computer science classes, but I was still unsure about choosing computer science as a major until I got an internship at a software development company. By building websites, I am able to think logically and analytically to solve problems through code, while also being able to express myself artistically through tangible applications. And I think that kind of sums up today, is you just sharing with one student, especially like a female or maybe an underrepresented student, that you can make the difference and you can put them on that career pathway. And we've seen for so many careers that are going to be, you know, better paying wages and stuff like that. So hopefully you'll stop and think about it. And hopefully you've learned a lot just in the 1 hour that we've had here. And I didn't know if we wanted to, did we need to tie up anything else, Dana or Christina?
We have time for, you know, questions if you guys wanted to chat about some stuff that you're doing and get some ideas or any questions you might have.
There was also a request to put the QR slide back up.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. I can do that real quick if you would like.
So, Mark, do you want to tell us what your student's doing too while Cheryl's doing that?
Okay. Everybody see that good?
Yeah. And some people are having trouble, I think, with the bit.ly code. Let me know if you are too. I'll drop like the whole long one in the chat also. So yeah, this kit that you guys are going to get, this is that one that a teacher picked up for me at a computer science teachers conference. I was like, oh, this says counselors. Let me like give this to my counselor. And the rest is history.
As everybody's wrapping up and getting the bit.lys and the links that are in the chat, I just want to thank this group. Appreciate it again, all of you coming and presenting to the to school counselors in Michigan. So can we give everybody a round? Can we give Dana, Christina, and Cheryl a round of applause? We'll give them some snaps. We'll give them some claps. I know there's some shout-outs in the chat box, too, about some of the great information that was learned and just opening eyes as to what the possibilities are here. So thank you so much for your time. We're looking forward to partnering with all of you again, and we hope all of you enjoyed it. And just so you know as well, we will be sending out the recorded version as well as the links to the Google Forms after today. So as soon as that recording gets processed, you'll get that in an email as long as you've registered. So thanks again for this team, and we appreciate you, definitely.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Cheryl, there's a question in the chat about whether it requires a teacher to be specifically certified in CS to be able to teach it in terms of addressing like the lack of access.
Great question. Actually, in 2017 or 2018, they took away the certification in computer science just because we didn't have enough teachers to be that were certified. So it allowed other teachers, as long as your school, you've had some sort of professional development in that field, in that area, they will let you teach computer science. So it's between you and your administrator. So yeah, any questions with that, they can come to me too. I can point them to the right resources in the state of Michigan, but do not have to be certified right now to teach computer science in Michigan, so.
Yeah, and that's also where some of those like club ideas came into about, you know, if your school doesn't have it, you know, could you partner with someone in the community to help run a club? Or
yeah, I think 4-H and Girl Scouts do some different things with if there's those are some clubs. There's a lot of, I mean, basically I've heard a lot of people just starting their own, you know, after school club. If they've never used a resource, it's called CS First and it's Google. It's a great resource just to get started. They're like 1 to 2 hour activities and you can easily do that over a week or two here and there. So yeah, clubs are just a great way to get students involved, and it doesn't have to be like a formal club. It can be just something fun that you do every once in a while after school. The kids love it. Terry and Cheryl, so if they fill out that form, that's the one thing that they need to do to get the credit for it? Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, and then if you get any follow-up questions like on that, just let us know. Or, I mean, they can get it up till March 4th, so we'll have this recording out and they can still complete the form. So even if they weren't able to watch the whole thing, or it looks like we still had some that weren't able to attend live, then they can still get that till March 4th.
Oh, yeah. Somebody said, yeah, the PIC is at school. Yeah, I understand. You got a little bit to do that, so.
I had to put my PIC in my phone. It's one of my contacts. That's a little, that helps.
Absolutely, Ken. There's a comment about school administrators may need more exposure to computer science curriculum. Absolutely.
Yes. And that's where, like I said, if I can help start working with districts, we need to get more PD for administrators, even something like this. Even an administrator would be, it would help them out a little bit, I think, too. So, but yeah, I will work on starting to get more of that on our Michigan page. Maybe we can share that out. So.
And if there are people that are interested in sort of, you know, like being champions in this work here in your state, there are definitely ways to do that. I mean, Christine and I are practicing full-time school counselors, but then, we do this work and presentations in our state as well. And then, you know, every once in a while we get borrowed by other states. So,
because we need a few people in our state who can do it too. Yeah.
Yeah. So they, you know, you guys can hear from each other. So, you know, tap in with Terry and Cheryl if, you know, this is a topic you'd be interested in digging in more with us.
Well, thanks again, team. It was good information. Appreciate it.
Yes. Thank you so much. This was wonderful. Can't wait for our April PD. So.
Definitely. Yeah, I was excited to see. I was a little worried with 500 people. I'm like, are they all going to be on really? So that was actually really good. There was 270 on at one time, I think. So that's great news.
Fantastic.
All right. Well, I'm going to pop off and then I will send the recording to all of you. I don't know if you all need it, but I'll send it to you as well, Cheryl. Okay.
Sounds good. Thank you, Terry. Right. Thank you, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.